Over the course of a calendar year in the forage specialist role, I probably dealt with 35 to 40 different forage species over the course of the growing season. We can divide those a number of ways. Their characteristics vary with how they're divided. They're either grasses or legumes as the majority of the forages, and in some cases they're neither classified as a legume or grass. We get into the brassicas, the turnips, the mustards. We can divide those again, a little different split. Some are annuals. All the characteristics of an annual. You plant a seed every year or volunteer year, seeds come up every year. The plant grows very rapidly, develops maturity, and produces seed in one growing season. These are generally high yield species because they're producing fairly quickly. Among the forages, oats would be a good example of an annual forage, and sometimes we use oats for that purpose. We also have perennials, plants that can live many, many years or forever if conditions are right. They never have to produce a seed to persist if they have adequate root system, storage, carbohydrate stores, and can recover and regrow very well as a long-term perennial. Most of those perennial forages are 4, 5, 6, 10-year kinds of species. We have some short-term or short-lived perennials, things like red clover. Seeding year plus one good growing year is about all we can expect in terms of strong productivity. They might persist another year or so in terms of presence. So we have some short-term perennials. Some red clover would be a good example of that. We have some definite biennials. They grow vegetatively in the seeding year and produce flowers in the second year. Sweet clover, both yellow and white flowered sweet clover, good examples of that. And how do you classify what we call winter annuals, things like winter wheat and rye? They grow vegetatively in the fall of one growing season and produce seed the following spring. So they're somewhere in between. They're relatively short-lived by comparison. So we can look at our forages that way, have some indication of some of your management requirements, the long-term management expectations. We can also divide them according to their growth habit. Some of them are very much upright growing. They're the ones that are most appropriate for mechanical harvest. They tend to be the tallest of the species. We have some low growing short types. Some of them actually spread across the ground, like white clover. Has stolons, like strawberry runners, very close to the ground. We have a few viney forage species that aren't probably as important in Iowa as they are in some of the other states, but they do have some viney characteristics. We generally divide our grasses into categories as being bunch grasses, where all the side branches and tillers are fairly close together. They form a dense clump rather than a spreading sod. The other type would be sod formers. Orchard grass and timothy would be examples of bunch grasses. Kentucky bluegrass is a sod former. Smooth brome grass, actually quack grass, falls in that edible weed category. It's a sod former as well. Can spread by underground rhizomes. From a selection standpoint, we may want some sod formers on our site to minimize some of the erosion risks. As I mentioned, try to mix tall grasses with tall legumes. Palatability from a mechanical harvest standpoint, from an animal grazing standpoint, they're eating plants about the same height throughout. Similarly, if your management is likely to be fairly continuous close grazing, those tall species seldom respond well to close frequent grazing. So pick species that will tolerate the kinds of grazing pressure that you're likely to throw at them over the course of their lifespan. So short legumes with short grasses that can tolerate close grazing. Vast majority of our forage produced in the state of Iowa is among these species. Many of these are legumes and grasses, cool season, generally perennial. There's some annuals there on the right. I threw corn in there. I threw oats in there, cereal, rye, because we are using them significantly. We can divide these plants by according to their physiology, their general growth. Many of our forage species we refer to as cool season species. Physiologically, their photosynthesis works best and is most efficient during the cool periods of the growing season, spring and fall. Some species have a distinct deficit in the summer simply because of their physiology. Summer slumps, not consistent across cool season species. Most of our legumes basically have this same physiology, even though they may have a little better summer growth pattern than some of the cool season grasses. Alternatively, we have some species that physiologically are warm season. They really don't start growing until May. Their productivity rate is greatest through June into July, maybe early August, and then slow down in September and stop with the first cold frosts. Distinctly different in terms of species. I guess our challenge, at least historically and on most of your farms, you probably have as a base cool season grass pastures. So they inherently have some issues. Excess production in the spring in most cases, quite often a summer deficit, and maybe can keep up with the fall production, maybe not. Depends on your stocking rates and so forth. Our challenge is how can we stabilize that productivity? Can we tweak it with forage species? Can we tweak it with forage management? And that becomes our challenge here in the Midwest U.S. We start with a Kentucky bluegrass pasture, and I don't know that I've ever seen a pure Kentucky bluegrass pasture ever. But from a productivity standpoint, we base all our yield estimates and comparisons and improvements on Kentucky bluegrass. It's a cool season grass, distinct summer slump. Its growth pattern starts somewhere in March, stops October-ish, early November, with little or no production. We can choose more productive cool season species. Brome grass, orchard grass, reed canary grass, tall fescue can be as much as twice as productive on the same site with the same fertility status as bluegrass. Unfortunately, it doesn't change that pattern. We just have more excess in the spring when we already may have excess. We don't necessarily have better summer growth. Some of our legumes actually have better summer yield production than bluegrass. So adding a legume to a bluegrass and or mixed cool season grass pasture adds some yield. Part of that is from nitrogen fixation, but also part of it is from the distribution of its growth through the season. So in and of itself, the legume does improve that distribution. So we need to think about whether including a legume is appropriate for our sites and our management. What about that warm season grass or warm season species? Seems to fill in that gap very nicely. It's productive when our cool seasons are not. So it's intriguing. As we look at our pastures, many of our annual grassy weeds are warm season grasses. Foxtail, crabgrass, actually are serving that role now as a warm season grass. We have some others that are possibles as well. From a forage selection and management situation, if you're planting or interseeding or tweaking your system, we don't typically recommend adding a warm season perennial species or annual species to a cool season grass. It's just too hard to manage everything and keep things growing well. Alternatively, we would suggest using dedicated warm season grass pastures or paddocks. Let them grow best and use them best when they're most appropriately used. So, if you're thinking about a warm season component to make up the deficit in the summer, think about multiple paddocks in a separate pasture or paddock or several for that purpose. So as you look at your whole farm plan, and this is part of your strategy, which pastures are going to be appropriate for warm season? They're probably not going to be the ones that you're going to be turning at calving time. These are probably ones that are going to be further back in the pasture rotation that you're going to be using later in the season.